dari Komplek Balai Budaya Minomartani Ngaglik Arena. Inilah Radio BBM, jaringan radio komunitas Yogyakarta.
Radio Komunitas Balai Budaya Minomartani. Radio Budaya, Radio Warga, Radio Kita Bersama.
Hello Warga Budaya, thank you for listening to BBM FM Community Radio, Yogyakarta, Indonesia.
Community Radio, BBM FM, creation for nation.
Radio Komunitas BBM FM, dukunglah budaya Indonesia.
...107.7 BBM FM Community Radio. Halo warga budaya, I'm Hizkia Plato Ginting from SV, and I'm with my friends Gian and Hanun. Today, we're going to talk about our experience at Pura Pakualaman Museum. Let's break it down from the beginning. So what do you guys think about Pura Pakualaman Museum?
So my first impression when I saw Pura Pakualaman was pure amazement, especially with that yellow buildings showcasing a especially with that yellow building showcasing European architecture yet still embracing Japanese culture. It has its own uniqueness that truly captivating, plus the historical stories add another layer of fascination, especially its connection with other kingdoms, being the last one built. And as I walked through it, I felt the pennies of this kingdom, and true enough, it covers a whopping 5 hectares.
I think since it was my first time visiting Pura Pakualaman, I thought that Pura Pakualaman is a good museum and very spacious for a museum. And I get to know a lot of new facts about Pura Pakualaman regarding some of the buildings in it that have functions and meanings for each building. I thought Pura Pakualaman was just an ordinary museum, and after visiting there, I found out that the place is not a museum. So, what do you think?
For me, I think that Pura Pakualaman is very unique compared to others. I thought I might be able to see historical object that was left many years ago, but turns out it's very different than what I've imagined. Compared to a museum, it looked more like a palace. It's spacious and beautiful with a lot of greenery. There were many rooms that been preserved. There were also colonial Netherlands style building, which attracts my attention the most. Overall, I have a great time exploring this place. Though, one complaint that I might have is that there weren't much we can do. We couldn't get close nor interact with the buildings. It's also under renovation, so we couldn't see the inside of the museum, which is a bummer. I still don't understand the background though. Can someone explain it to me?
Okay, Puro Pakualaman is the last kingdom built in 1812, governed by Kanjeng Gusting Pangeran Kadipaten Pakualaman. Puro Pakualaman was established on Sultan Agung Street, not far from the Yogyakarta Palace. In reality, its architectural structure was modest, comprising a pavilion, an outdoor garden, and supporting buildings. During the reign of Pakualaman IV, an earthquake occurred, causing significant damage to many buildings. Therefore, the current structures have undergone numerous modifications since the initial constructions in 1812, and for now, Puro Pakualaman has become a cultural heritage site.
Supporting buildings, can you tell me more about it?
So, there are two places outside the museum. In the southern part, there's this open space called Swandanan Square. Back in the day, it was filled with banyan and tanjung trees, but now only a few remain on the eastern side nowadays. So there are two places outside the museum. In the eastern part, there's this open space called Swandanan Square. Back in the day, it was filled with banyan and tanjung trees, but now only a few remain on the eastern sides. Nowadays, it mostly used for parking and street vendors. However, on certain days, Swandanan Square is used for religious celebrations, national holidays, or other public events. Now, in the southwest corner of Puro Pakualaman, there's Pakualaman Mosque. The mosque has undergone some changes in its original form, but there's no detailed record of this except for inscriptions. There are four inscriptions, two in Javanese script and the other two in Arabic script, marking the establishment of the mosque. In a nutshell, the inscription state that the mosque was built on Sunday pond, December 8, 1939, initiated by the congregation led by Kanjeng Gusti Pangeran Adipati Rider Pakualam II, assisted by Patih Raden Ria Natareja and Mas Penghulu Mustahil Tamat.
Apart from the buildings that you mentioned, there are other structures located on the west and east side as supporting faculties. I think one of them is the backyard. The backyard is situated in the north of Sewarenga Hall. It used to have various large plants like jackfruit, mango, langsat, and more. Do you guys know any more buildings?
Oh yeah, I know it. And there is gazebo, or full pavilion and swimming pool. On the west side of the backyard, there used to be a water pavilion or gazebo called Balai Kambang. The building that was once used to enhance the garden is no longer there. Meanwhile, on the east side of the backyard, there was a swimming pool that was once used by the sons and daughters of Pabu Alara. However, the swimming pool no longer exists. And west and east wing buildings at the back. Running north-south on both the west and east sides, there are parts of the west and east wings building used strong for Puro Pakualaman's household equipment. In the east, there are remnants of a kitchen. For two others, I forgot.
Okay, I know about the other, like walls parading the backyard. In the north, there's a wall separating the backyard from the northernmost courtyard, which was once used for military training activities before independence. The wall has a door connecting the backyard to the military training area. The former military training ground has undergone several changes and no longer exists, and stables. To the west of the west wing building of Pura Pakualaman, there used to be a spacious courtyard. As the name suggests, this area was originally used as a horse stable. On the south side, it was later transformed into a garden with deer. Nowadays, this area is used for traditional martial arts training or emparingan.
So, what is the current use of the buildings?
So there are annual activities taking place at Pura Pakualaman, like the annual Garebeg Agenda. The annual Garebeg has three types of events. The first one is the Maulid Garebeg. As you know, Maulid Nabi is an event held to commemorate the birthday of the Prophet in Islam. And the second one is the Sawal Garebeg. This event is done to commemorate the month of Sawal, usually held on the first day at Pura Pakualaman. And the third one, the Grand Garebeg. Well, this event is much bigger compared to the other two Garebegs. It is held to celebrate the Eid al-Adha at that place.
The next question that I have is that what traditional activities are there inside of Pura Pakualaman?
So there are also traditional activities like commemorating First Suro or Japanese New Year. It's not just First Suro that is commemorated, but when it's 10 Suro, there are specific agendas in events. What's more interesting is the Saturday Kliwon activity at Pura Pakualaman. This activity includes various events and competitions. There's the changing of the guard ceremony, where the guard changes from Lombok Abang to Plangkir or vice versa. This happens every 8 or 35 days.
Is there any activities left or is that just it?
Then there is a culture seminar. As the name suggests, it focuses on culture, educational themes, and their relation to the current conditions, including Japanese cultural myths, located at Kepatihan Pakualam. Even more exciting, there's the Gamelan Dalem Bangsal Suwata Pura Pakualaman game broadcast live by RRI.
There's an archery competition too, to commemorate the legacy of Dalem KGPAA Pakualam 10. Oh yeah, for your information guys, Pura Pakualaman isn't open to the public right now. It's kind of temporarily closed.
Oh yeah, why?
Well, the reason is they're doing some renovations, like I mentioned earlier. There are annual activities at Pura Pakualaman, so they are taking care of and renovating it to preserve its cultural value.
Wouldn't it change the uniqueness of the pura if there were a lot of renovation?
Nope, don't worry. The renovation won't change the unique vibe of Pura Pakualaman. It's more like a touch-up, you know, like repainting or re-rigging stuff.
When do you guys think Pura Pakualaman will be open again to the public? Will it be closed for a long period of time?
No, they said that Pura Pakualaman will be open to the public once the renovation are done, probably next year.
So, before we move on to the next topic, please enjoy this little song. So, we are going to continue our topic after this little song. After that, we are going to play a recording of our interview with Kanjeng Raden Tumenggung Projo Anggono in Indonesian language. Stay tuned.
Thank you. termasuk bangunan bersejarah atau museum?
Jadi begini ya, Mbak ya. Kabupaten Pakualaman itu berdiri paling akhir pada suatu kerajaan yang ada di Jawa ini, berupa Mataram Islam. Itu yang pertama kali Surakarta, itu ada Kasunanan, Kendal Mangkunegaran, kemudian Kasultanan sini. Ini baru Pakualaman tahun 1812. Ya, itu jadi kerajaan. Jadi bangunan ini sudah dibangun sejak tahun 1812, walaupun bentuknya tidak seperti dulu, masih kecil dan perjalanan. Nah, siapa yang memegang di sini, penguasanya, rajanya siapa namanya? Itu namanya Kanjeng Gusti Pangeran Adipati Pakualaman. Sekarang sudah yang ke-10. Usia kabupaten ini sudah 211 tahun. Lama kan?
Ya.
Artinya kalau lama ini menjadi sebuah cagar budaya. Ya, cagar budaya. Demikian juga keraton sana, yang keraton besar, Kasultanan juga cagar budaya. Ini ya, bangunannya termasuk itu, dan budayanya juga menjadi bagian yang perlu terus dilestarikan terus menerus, baik itu bentuk bangunan fisiknya maupun non fisik, tak benda, yaitu ada tarinya, ada ininya, itu kira-kira semacam itu. Ya.
Berarti ini masih berhubungan dengan seperti keraton-keraton gitu ya?
Ya, namanya kerajaan itu kan keraton.
Iya.
Iya. Jadi Mataram Islam itu dulu, itu pertama Surakarta, Kasunanan, Amangkura, kemudian pada saat itu Perjanjian Giyanti 1755, tahun 1755 Masehi, itu pecah menjadi dua, Surakarta atau Solo sekarang lah gampangnya, dan Yogyakarta. Itu Mataram Yogyakarta. Nah, Mataram Yogyakarta itu dulu Pangeran Mangkubumi itu yang nantinya akan menjadi raja pertama kali Kasultanan Yogyakarta ini, namanya Hamengkubuwono yang pertama. Kemudian Hamengkubuwono pertama ini punya putra banyak, di antaranya itu Pangeran Hadiokusumo yang akhirnya nanti mendirikan satu keraton lebih kecil dari, walaupun itu menjadi satu bagian keraton bersaudara ya, di sana. Ini nanti keraton tersendiri, tapi derajatnya adipati itu boleh mempunyai wilayah, boleh mempunyai pemerintahan sendiri gitu kan, tetapi harus juga bersamaan dengan keraton, statusnya di bawah keraton sana. Ini bisa paham ya, ini bisa ngerti.
Kalau makna dari nama Purwakualaman ini sendiri itu apa, Pak?
Maksudnya makna?
Iya.
Ya. Jadi begini, perjalanan sejarah di sana itu namanya Kasunanan, rajanya, ya, rajanya itu namanya Pakubuwono. Jadi Buwono itu bumi, di Paku. Ya, tapi dalam tanda harfiah petik ya, bukan artinya. Kemudian Mangkunegara. Mangkunegara itu memangku pemerintahan. Nah, sini Hamengku itu apa ya, menjunjung. Karena pemerintahan jelas kan, sana punya masa, punya rakyat, punya wilayah, punya pemerintahan dan sebagainya. Nah, yang terakhir ini Paku Alam, alamnya yang dipaku.
Makanya ini juga yang jadi yang terakhir gitu.
Iya, terakhir alamnya yang dipaku. walaupun itu kecil sendiri. Bandingan yang ketiga itu kita kecil sendiri. Itu kira-kira. Zah, monggo kalau mau keluar. Nah, itu bawa saja.
Iya, makasih ya Pak. Makasih, Pak. Makasih banyak Pak.
So that's our song and a little interview. Then let's continue with our topic. Okay, warga budaya, as we mentioned before, we're going to continue on our topic. My next question is, why is it called Pura Pakualaman?
Pura in Indonesia means palace. Meanwhile, in Javanese, according to the Bahusastra Dictionary, it means kraton or kadaton or papan kanggo sembayang tumrap wong Hindu. That's place for people who practice Hinduism pray.
So, Pura really means the residence of the king? That's kind of cool.
Yeah, that's right.
Then, why is it not called a palace?
Because palace is an Indonesian term, not a Japanese term. In Japanese, there is a related word, namely astana, and it means it's term for members of the royal family.
And the leaders of Pakualaman Yogyakarta and Mangkunegara Surakarta have the status of duke or prince, not as king or sultan or sunan, who have the status of the highest leader of the people. Because his status is not the highest leader, the residence of the leaders of Pakualaman Yogyakarta and Mangkunegara Surakarta should not be called a palace, not only a pura. The term pura here is not a Hindu religious place of worship, but comes from a Sanskrit term which means fort, castle, or walled residence.
In fact, it may be called a palace in Indonesian, but it is different from the term in Japanese. Moreover, if we look at the state hierarchy at that time.
So that's the reason why the building is named Pura Pakualaman then?
Yeah, that's right. Then what makes Pura Pakualaman so special? Isn't it the same like other museum?
Okay, Pura Pakualaman is a bit different than others museum because it has things that can't be seen with the naked eyes. They don't have many materialistic objects, but they doesn't mean that they are poor. They mostly focus on knowledge.
You're right. One of the examples is Ki Hajar Dewantara. Do you know who he is? He's the father of knowledge. He came from this place because he is the grandson of Sri Pakualam III. Isn't it amazing though? We are sitting in the place where Ki Hajar Dewantara once lived. The second example is that there is also the statue of Ganesha in Pura Pakualaman.
The Ganesha statue? What does it symbolize?
The Ganesha statue symbolizes knowledge. It's very fitting for this place.
If this place is focused on knowledge, then what does the people do inside of Pura Pakualaman?
Besides sightseeing, of course, most people came here to study the history and biography of people that once hold a title here. For example, the first indigenous Bachelor of Engineering came from this place. You can see their records from the library that's located inside of the building.
Also, you can even see students gathering at the library to work on their thesis.
I think now I know why Pura Pakualaman is special. It's really unique compared to other museums.
Here's a fun fact. The first president of Indonesia, Soekarno-Hatta, and his family moved to Pura Pakualaman and lived there because of government issue. Because of that, there were rumors spreading around that Yogyakarta will be the new capital city of Indonesia.
We could also see the culture and hierarchy of that place is still used till this day.
In Pura Pakualaman, there's an interesting tradition regarding footwear. Those with lower ranks or position that are not allowed to wear footwear within the Pura premise On the flip side, individual with royal blood or lineage hold higher position, and as a result, they are required to wear footwear when entering Pura Pakualaman. This tradition adds unique touch, reflecting the significance of social hierarchy and lineage within the cultural practice of the palace. It is a distinctive aspect that emphasizes the respect for tradition and status within the Pura Pakualaman community. Wow, we discussed a lot, huh? It will show how unique this museum is.
Right? People will be interested in learning the story of this museum.
So some people might not be interested in this because it doesn't have much thing to display. It's also under renovation, so it's closed to the public.
I think that's about Pura Pakualaman. It's a shame that we couldn't visit it because it's currently under renovation.
Maybe we can visit this museum again, but I think that's all from us. Thanks for listening to our broadcast.
Bye. Bye.
Terima kasih. Anda sedang mendengarkan Radio Komunitas BBM FM 107,7 MHz.
Dipancarkan dari kawasan Balai Budaya Minomartani, Radio Komunitas BBM FM.